Okay, good evening everybody and welcome to day 3 of this PG session. We have with us today Dr. Manish Patil, who is a fellow in cardiac anesthesia and currently working as associate professor in Department of Anesthesia, TNMC and BYL Nair Hospital. He will present anemia in pregnancy. Over to you, Manish.
Thank you, madam. Good evening, everybody. I'll be presenting on anemia in pregnancy. So to start with the presentation, we should know what the name anemia means. In ancient Greek, an means not and he means blood. So it literally means lack of blood. Now anemia is the most commonly encountered medical disorder during pregnancy. As per the WHO, 56% of all women living in developing countries are anemic. And as per the National Family Health Survey of India, 54% of women in rural, whereas 46% of women in urban areas are anemic. Directly or indirectly, it is the most contributory factor for maternal and perinatal mortality and morbidity. Nutritional anemia, that is iron deficiency anemia, is the commonest. Now, oxygen is carried in two forms in RBC. First is dissolved in RBC water, and second is reversibly bound to hemoglobin molecule. Now, the hemoglobin molecule has four subunits, heme group and two globin chain. Globin chain are responsible for the different types of hemoglobin available. Hemoglobin A constitutes 92% of adult hemoglobin, whereas the heme group constitutes ferrous ion, which is responsible for oxygen transport. Anemia in pregnancy is defined as hemoglobin concentration of less than 11 gram per dl or hematocrit less than 33% in venous blood. But the Center for Disease Control and Prevention has defined anemia in pregnancy as less than 11 gram in first and third trimester and less than 10.5 grams in second trimester, whereas FOCG has given a cutoff for India as 10 gram per dl. So anemia can be classified by different ways. As per etiology, it can be classified as physiological anemia of pregnancy, acquired or genetic. For physiological anemia of pregnancy to be defined as, the hemoglobin has to be 10 grams, RBC volume should be 3.2 million per cubic meter, PCT should be 30, and the peripheral smear should show a normal morphology of RBC with central pallor. The acquired causes are nutritional, like iron deficiency, folate, B12. Infectious causes are malaria, hookworm, hemorrhagic, acute or chronic blood loss, bone marrow suppression as seen in aplastic anemia and few drugs, and renal diseases. Whereas the genetic hemoglobinopathies are sickle cell disease and thalassemia. Based on morphology, they again can be classified into three groups, like normocytic, normochromic, microcytic, hypochromic, and macrocytic. In normochromic, normocytic anemia, all the blood indices like MCV, MCH, and MCSC are normal. It's usually seen in acute blood loss, hemolytic anemia, and bone marrow failure. Whereas in microcytic hypochromic anemia, all the indices are reduced. This is seen in iron deficiency and sideroblastic anemia and thalassemia. Whereas in microcytic, the MCV is above normal, that is more than 100 per FL. It is seen in vitamin B12 and folic acid deficiency. Again, the ICMR has graded the anemia as per the severity. Mild anemia is 10 to 11, moderate is 7 to 10, severe is less than 7, whereas very severe is less than 4. Now, what hematological changes occurred during pregnancy? We have to remember that apart from physiological anemia, neutrophilia, mild thrombocytopenia, increased prograden factors, and decreased fibrinogenesis is present during pregnancy. Now, what other major changes occur? First is, there is increase in maternal blood volume by almost 45 to 50%. It starts at the 6 week, continues till 34 weeks, then it comes back to the normal level by 10 to 14 days postpartum. This is an adaptive hypovolemia to maintain the BP, as well as it helps in facilitating maternal and fetal exchanges of gases, nutrients, and metabolites. It also protects mother from hypotension by reducing the risk associated with hemorrhage at delivery. The causes for this increase in blood volume is estrogen, progesterone, both maternal as well as fetal. Progesterone also stimulates the aldosterone production and stimulates the renin-angiotensin system. RBC volume also increases by 20 to 30%, but during the first 8 weeks, it decreases. It starts increasing by 8 to 16 weeks, comes back to the pre-pregnancy level by 16 weeks, and again starts increasing and goes up to 30% of pre-pregnancy level at term. The cause for this RBC volume increase is erythropoietin and erythropoietic effects of progesterone, prolactin, and placental lactogen. But we have to remember that the plasma volume expansion is more than the rise in RBC volume expansion. This results in hemodilution and consequently physiological anemia of pregnancy. This helps in decreasing the viscosity and helps reduces the resistance to blood flow. Now, coming to the pathophysiology of anemia in pregnancy, as I have already told, oxygen is carried in blood in two forms. One is physical solution in plasma and RBC, that is dissolved form 2%, and reversibly chemically bound to hemoglobin. It constitutes 98%. The normal O2 combined with hemoglobin in body is 1.37 to 1.36 ml per gram of hemoglobin. To know the pathophysiology of anemia and pregnancy, we should know what is the CaO2, that is O2 content of the blood, oxygen flush, oxygen delivery, and oxygen consumption. Now, O2 content of the blood, as the formula is showing you, is directly related to the hemoglobin concentration, the saturation, and the partial pressure of O2. In normal circumstances, the O2 content of the blood is 20 ml per dL. Hence, this formula tells us that when the hemoglobin concentration falls by 50%, the O2 content is decreased to 10 ml per dL. Also, oxygen flux is the O2 pumped into the body per minute, and oxygen delivery is the quantity of O2 delivered to the tissue. Again, these two are directly related to the cardiac output and the CaO2, which indirectly is dependent on HB, partial pressure of oxygen, and saturation. Oxygen consumption tells us about the adequacy of tissue oxygenation. Again, it is directly related to cardiac output, HB, SVO2, SVO2, SaO2, and PaO2. Now, from this, we can say that the oxygen delivery not only depends on the cardiac output, it also depends on O2 extraction, saturation, and partial pressure of oxygen relationship. And this is best described by the oxygen dissociation curve. It is a sigmoid-shaped curve. Sigmoid-shaped why? Because oxygenation of one subunit of hemoglobin facilitates 300 times greater affinity of O2 to the other subunit, as well as release of O2 from one subunit facilitates release of further O2. Thus, the importance of this is that rapid descent allows a larger fraction of O2 to be released to the tissue with a moderate drop of partial pressure of oxygen. This is the oxygen dissociation curve. Now, what is P50? P50 is a partial pressure of oxygen at which the hemoglobin is 50% saturated. It basically measures the affinity of hemoglobin to the oxygen. Now, this shift of right or left of oxygen dissociation curve can occur. The causes here for leftward shift is increase in pH, decrease in partial pressure of CO2, decrease in 2,3-diphosphoglycerate, decrease in temperature. The leftward shift signifies that there is increased oxygen affinity and hence enhanced binding. Whereas causes for rightward shift are increased H plus ion concentration, increased hypercarbia, increased 2,3-DPG, increased temperature. The rightward shift decreases the affinity of oxygen for hemoglobin and enhances oxygen release to the tissue. Also to remember that the level of 2,3-DPG in pregnancy increases. What is 2,3-DPG? It is a metabolite of anaerobic metabolism, that is glycolysis. And the normal RBC concentration is 50 micromoles per dL. It binds to the beta chain of hemoglobin and decreases the affinity of oxygen and hence promotes the release of remaining oxygen. It is increased in anemia as well as chronic hypoxemia, whereas it is decreased in liver diseases and hypophosphatemia. So to summarize, we can say that in an anemic pregnant patient, various compensatory mechanisms get activated, like increase in cardiac output, decrease in blood viscosity, rightward shift of the oxygen dissociation curve, increase in 2,3-DPG concentrations in the RBC, and release of renin erythropoietin, which stimulates the erythroid precursors in the bone marrow. Thus, in normal circumstances, the tissue oxygenation is not impaired during physiological or chronic anemia. But if there is very severe anemia or acute onset anemia, this can lead to serious consequences. Coming to the effects of anemia on mother, mild anemia does not have any effect on pregnancy or labor, but the mother may have low iron stores for further pregnancies. Whereas in moderate anemia, mother may suffer from increased weakness, lack of energy, fatigue, and poor work performance. Whereas severe anemia, mother may land up in features of cardiac failure like palpitation, tachycardia, breathlessness, and may further be decompensated. Whereas anemia in pregnancy, there is higher incidences of pregnancy complications like preeclampsia, preterm labor, and abruptio placenta. Also, anemia predisposes to infections like urinary tract infection, puerperal sepsis. There is increased risk of postpartum hemorrhage, subinvolution of uterus, and lactational failures. And anemia in pregnancy is an important cause for maternal mortality because of congestive heart failure, cerebral anoxia, sepsis, and thrombocytopenia. Thromboembolism. Now, effect of anemia on fetus and neonate. In neonate, there are higher instances of abortion, preterm birth, IUGR, intrauterine death, low APGAR scores at birth. Neonates are susceptible to anemia and infection. There are higher instances of perinatal mortality and morbidity. And some studies have shown that anemic infants may have cognitive and affective dysfunction. So management of coming to management of anemia. Management of anemia should start with prevention of anemia. So proper for prevention, proper antenatal care, dietary supplementation, treatment of infections like hookworm, and prophylactic iron supplements should be given. Treatment, antenatal treatment consists of find out the type and severity of anemia, treat the underlying cause. If it's iron deficiency, give iron. If megaloblastic, then folic acid, iron. If dimorphic, then give all three. And to remember that, along with treating the underlying cause, how remote is pregnancy from the term? If it's remote, then you can give oral or parenteral therapy. If it's near term or it's severe anemia, you can give blood transfusion. We'll talk about iron deficiency because it's the commonest found anemia in pregnancy in India. Iron requirement in pregnancy is increased because of increase in red cell mass, growing fetus, placenta, and cord. The total demand is almost 4 mg per dl during pregnancy. Also during pregnancy, there is decreased total iron store and serum ferritin majorly in the third trimester. And the diagnosis for iron deficiency anemia is by microcytic hypochromic picture of RBCs in the peripheral smear and serum ferritin level below 12. Again, for prophylaxis, iron-rich food and supplementation should be given. And treatment can be given by oral or parenteral iron therapy. The response is seen after 5 to 10 days by reticulocytosis. Now, when to give blood transfusion? There is no term like minimal acceptable level of hemoglobin. Many task force guidelines have recommended that RBC transfusion should not be dictated by a single RBC trigger. Instead, it should be based on patient's need, the risk of developing complications of inadequate oxygenation, and hence the decision should be made both clinically as well as on hematological ground. And to remember that the healthy myocardium compensates for low hemoglobin, that is up to 7 to 8 gram per dl. So as you can say that about 10 gram transfusion, hemoglobin about 10 gram transfusion is rarely indicated. Below 6, it should be given, and between 7 to 8 gram per dl, depending if the patient is in labor or postpartum, depending upon the severity, the coexisting medical condition, and risk of continuing blood loss, blood transfusion can be given. So, blood transfusion to be given in decompensated state or when you need rapid rise in hemoglobin, and fresh packeted cells should be given in severe anemia. The other indications for blood transfusion are severe anemia, first seen after 36 weeks of pregnancy, anemia due to acute blood loss like antepartum or postpartum hemorrhage, if anemia is associated with severe infection and it's not responding to oral or parenteral therapy. Also, symptomatic pregnant woman, irrespective of the gestational age, if they are symptomatic, blood transfusion should be given. Other treatment modality is erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is given in erythropoietin deficiency anemias or severe or progressive iron deficiency anemia, or when the patient refuses for blood transfusion in autologous bone donation cases or in pre- or post-operative patients or with hemoglobinopathies. Coming to anesthesia consideration, our pre-operative assessment should be focused on assessment of the cause, type, the severity of anemia, and the adequacy of compensatory mechanisms. For this, we should have a proper history. We should rule out proper history suggestive of poor tissue perfusion like tiredness, easy fatigability, palpitation, angina. And we should look for signs of high cardiac output like tachycardia, white pulse pressure, systolic ejection fraction. Also, investigations like complete hematogram, peripheral smear, reticulocyte to identify the type and severity of anemia. Also, other investigations like HB, electrophoresis, ECG can be carried out. Now, the choice of anesthesia, all type of anesthesia can be given. But the choice of anesthesia depends on the severity, the type of anemia, the extent of physiological compensation, the concomitant medical conditions, the type and nature of the procedure which the patient is undergoing, and anticipated blood loss. For general anesthesia, our aim should be to avoid hypoxia so as to minimize the factors interfering with O2 delivery and to prevent any increase in O2 consumption to optimize the partial pressure of O2 in the arterial blood. The second aim is to avoid decrease in cardiac output, which is a compensatory mechanism for maintaining tissue oxygenation, and to avoid leftward shift of oxygen desaturation curve. For avoidance of hypoxia, in many centers, pre-oxygenation with 100% oxygen for 5 minutes is recommended. Also, oxygen supplementation should be given in peri and post-operative period. Airway should be properly maintained so as to prevent fall in FiO2 because of airway obstruction or difficult airway. Also, we should avoid or aggressively manage conditions which increase the O2 demand, like fever, shivering, and acute massive blood loss. For maintaining cardiac output, intravenous induction should be slowly and titrated. Also, positioning of the patient is important because position-associated volume shifts are known. And to remember that mild tachycardia and white pulse pressure are physiological and should not be considered with light plane of anesthesia. Factors causing leftward shift of oxygen desaturation curve like hyperventilation should be avoided. Also, hypothermia should be avoided. Patient should be given warm fluids and external warmers can be applied. Now, regional anesthesia can be given in this patient if they are posted for some other surgeries. Regional anesthesia like blocks are assured with reduced blood loss. Also, central neuroaxial blocks with low-dose spinal anesthesia along with adjuvant or intermittent dose or continuous epidural can be used. But to remember that supplemental oxygen should be given in these patients in the form of nasal prongs, polymasks, or ventimasks. The advantages of regional anesthesia are good analgesia, decreased blood loss, and stable hemodynamics. But the disadvantage is that in eminent there is hypotension, if the patient is fluid resuscitated, further hemodilution can occur and this can cause heart failure. Also, in cases of subacute degeneration of spinal cord, which is associated with vitamin B12 deficiency, the neurological symptoms of the patient can worsen. I'll give a note on sickle cell anemia and thalassemia. Now, sickle cell anemia, here the hemoglobin A, which is normally present, has been replaced by hemoglobin S, which has higher propensity of aggregation if the PO2 falls. Aggregation begins when the PO2 is below 50, and all hemoglobins are aggregated if the PO2 is less than 23. This is sickling. And the causes for sickling or aggravating factors for sickling are dehydration, hypotension, hyperthermia, acidosis, high concentrations of HBS. And it is in pregnancy, it is associated with increased incidence of preterm labor, placenta abruptia, placenta previa, and hypertensive disorders. For anesthesia management, our aim is to avoid factors which cause sickling like hypoxia, hypovolemia, hypothermia, or acidosis, provide good analgesia, and all anesthesia techniques and neuroaxial general anesthesia can be used. Always remember that the patient should be adequately hydrated with crystalloid. And blood transfusion goals in a case of sickle cell anemia are to maintain a hemoglobin concentration above 8 gram and the hemoglobin A concentration should be 40% of the total hemoglobin. Thalassemia again is a microcytic hemolytic anemia. Here the problem is with the polypeptide globin chain. In pregnancy, thalassemia patients require higher transfusion. There is risk of hemosiderosis and cardiac failure. The anesthetic considerations here are the patient is already has chronic anemia, may have tissue hypoxia, patient already had received multiple transfusion, so he may have iron overload, especially in the myocardial cells and airway, so difficult airway may be there. In this, again, both general anesthesia and neuroaxial anesthesia techniques can be used. But we have to rule out difficult intubation and myocardial hemosiderosis. So to conclude, we can say understanding of normal and compensatory mechanisms is important so as to optimize tissue oxygenation, which is our main goal. The aim is to maintain a fine balance between the compensatory mechanism and the adequate tissue perfusion in these patients. Monitoring of adequacy of perfusion and oxygenation is important. Also, the magnitude of ongoing losses should be monitored. We should anticipate and manage the effects of chronic tissue hypoxemia and major blood losses perioperatively. And both type of anesthesia can be judiciously used. we'll come to a few MCQs. Now, which complication is not associated with pregnancy in anemia? PIH, preterm labor, gestational diabetes mellitus, or puerperal sepsis? Answer is gestational diabetes. All three are associated with anemia and pregnancy.
I think it is stuck, is it?
No, it's moving. Okay. Hello?
Okay.
Yeah. What are the compensatory responses to anemia? Except reduction in cardiac output, increase in 2-3 DPG, increased affinity of hemoglobin for oxygen, and increased erythropoiesis. Among this, always remember that cardiac output increases to maintain the tissue oxygenation. Also, 2-3 DPG increases, I already told you. The affinity of hemoglobin to oxygen is decreased as the oxygen diffusion curve is shifted to the right. And again, there is increase in erythropoiesis. So, A and C are wrong answers. Now, coming to third question. The oxygen content of arterial blood with the same PO2 level is raised by increased hematocrit, temperature, anemia, increased 2-3 DPG, or increased PCO2. Answer is C, because oxygen content of the arterial blood is directly related to hemoglobin concentration. Mother with anemia during pregnancy are risk for heart failure, preterm labor, puerperal sepsis, or all of the above? Answer is all of the above. No. All are the causes of anemia in pregnancy except nutritional deficiency, bone marrow suppression, blood loss, or increased red cell mass. Answer is B. Bone marrow suppression. There is increased erythropoiesis. Now coming to sickling of pregnancy. Sickle cell anemia and during pregnancy. What are the causes of sickling? That is aggregation of RBCs. Dehydration, hypotension, hypothermia, or acidosis. All are correct here. All cause sickling, and hence a patient with sickle cell anemia should be properly hydrated and warm. Thank you. Madam?
Yeah. Sorry, ma'am. Thank you, Manish. Yeah. Thank you, Manish. Varun, are there any questions in the chat box? Hello? Yeah, are there any questions in the chat box, Varun?
No, ma'am, it's not there.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Manish, for that wonderful lecture. I think
thank
we can.
You,
can we end the session now?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manish.
लैग है मैं बता दूं तेरे को रुक जा डाला तूने ना हाँ आया हुआ है यस मैम वी हैव डन द सेशन
या ओके थैंक यू
सो मच मैम थैंक्स सर थैंक्स फॉर जॉइनिंग
या थैंक यू वेलकम सर